Geronimo Jaga Pratt has spent the last 18 years in prison for a crime he did not commit. Substantial evidence has been uncovered pointing to a deliberate FBI frame-up. In fact, the main prosecution witness at the trial was proven to be a paid FBI informant. Despite this and other evidence, the courts refused to grant Geronimo a new trial, and the parole board refuses to release him. Geronimo Pratt is being held for no other reason than his political beliefs. He has said, "If I'd actually committed the murder, I'd be out by now. The longer I'm in prison, the more clear it is that the murder isn't why I'm here." Why won't the U.S. government set Geronimo Pratt free?
I know where this inspiration is at in a legendary man named Geronimo Pratt.
Geronimo Pratt! Who's the real terrorist? Who's the freedom fighter?
Geronimo Pratt!
The movement to free Geronimo Pratt is happening in courts, in communities, in Congress, and internationally. Recently, Congressman Ronald Dellums introduced a congressional resolution calling for an investigation into Geronimo's case and those of other political prisoners. In 1980, Amnesty International stated, "The interest of justice can only be served by granting Mr. Pratt a new trial."
And government conspiracy!
In 1987, at a demonstration at the District Parole Board office in San Francisco, Geronimo's wife, Ashaki Pratt, read a statement from Geronimo.
I want to thank everyone for your active support, the letters, the petitions, and your presence here today. I want you to know that whatever the parole board decides today, I intend to keep on struggling, not only for my own release, but for the release of all political prisoners and the prisoners of war of injustice, incarcerated in the dungeons of the United States. All around the world, human beings fight against injustice and for their people and their nation. In Azania, in Ireland, in El Salvador, in Chile, and all around the world, governments lock up and criminalize people who resist oppression, racism, and always affirm the right to resist, the right to struggle for freedom. This is something that they can never take away. I'm 100% innocent of the charges for which I have spent 17 years of my life in prison.
When Geronimo Pratt sits in San Quentin, where he's been for 17 years, he was head of the Panther Party in Los Angeles in 1970. And all of a sudden in 70, he was charged with the murder in 1968 of a white school teacher in the Santa Monica tennis courts. He went to trial in 1972 on some evidence, and he got convicted. What has occurred since 1975 is that people working with him have discovered that there was a massive program to frame him for anything, and this murder was the way they framed him. The program was called the Counterintelligence Program. It was a program by the FBI to get rid of black extremists, and in particular the Panther Party in the late 60s and early 70s, and in particular Geronimo Pratt. And what we can say now is that we know through the FBI's own documents that they had an informant who committed perjury in the trial. He said, this man, Julius Butler, said, "I never worked for the FBI," and Geronimo confessed the murder to me. That man was an FBI informant. The FBI has now admitted it. We know that the FBI put informants in Geronimo's defense team, that is, people who worked for Geronimo's lawyer, were FBI agents reporting to the FBI about his defense, something totally important to our system of justice, which is probably have a right to defend yourself. We know that the witness who ID'd him as the killer, the husband of the woman who died, ID'd somebody else a year before as positively the killer, but that person couldn't have done it because he was in jail at the time.
We also know that the FBI withheld documents throughout the trial. The FBI was in possession of wiretaps which might serve to confirm Geronimo's alibi. Those surveillance records have mysteriously disappeared. A retired FBI agent now says that Geronimo and the Black Panther Party were prime targets of the illegal COINTEL program.
We have found out that Geronimo didn't get a fair trial. I'm convinced he's innocent, but the FBI continues to fight to hide the information from us. I think for the same reasons why they initially put him in prison. They don't want strong black leaders in this country. They didn't want him in the early 70s, and they don't want him now.
Just to compliment that, I'd like to just read a little phrase, which is actually from one of the FBI's own documents from that period of time. And it talks about the goal of the counterintelligence program that Stewart's been talking about. And one, the first goal, the primary goal, is to prevent the coalition of militant black nationalist groups. In unity, there is strength, a truism that is no less valid for all its triteness. Their second main objective was to prevent the rise of a messiah who would unify, electrify the militant black national movement. And among other people that they cite as probably the most dangerous was Martin Luther King. This was J. Edgar Hoover and his legacy out to destroy black leadership.
Geronimo Pratt spent 8 years in solitary confinement until he sued the prison system for violation of constitutional rights and won. This forced the courts to acknowledge the political nature of this additional punishment and to order him released to the general prison population. He is still serving a sentence of 7 years to life. We interviewed Geronimo in July 1987 in San Quentin Prison, California. He explained the historical context of his case.
They painted us in the eyes of many who still believe to this day. A lot of those lies and myths. And they had to criminalize us, make us criminals to justify their assaults against us. Fred Hampton had just gotten, he was murdered in his sleep in Chicago, like 4 days prior to the police coming and trying to do the same thing in Los Angeles. Our offices in Seattle was attacked. The one in, this is by the police working in cahoots with the certain elements of the federal government from J. Edgar Hoover's regime that he had control of. The Des Moines chapter of the Black Panther Party was completely blown off the face of the map, dynamited, completely blown up. Luckily, no one was killed in Des Moines. I mentioned Chicago, you had the Kansas City attacks by the police. This was like a nationwide coordinated police attack on the Panther officers throughout. The main reason that I saw and what attracted me to this organization, excuse me, was the deep sense of commitment and seriousness that I saw. They started programs such as the Breakfast for Children program, the free the clothing giveaway, the free shoe giveaway, give away free shoes and whatnot. And what they were doing were actually trying to realize these things based on self-reliance and independence and building autonomous situations so the people in the community didn't have to rely on so much on the powers that be. Internationally, we, I wouldn't say posed a threat, but we had a lot of promises. We were very promising. The whole movement was very promising, was hooking up on with a lot of third world movements throughout the world. See, when like the Norths or the Poindexters or the Reagans, and when they explain this, it's that all these terrorists spreading out. That's not true. When, from our perspective, it's beautiful, peace-loving people are struggling to come together and to live. You know, people who don't have these nuclear weapons and stuff, who threaten the whole world, to come together and to discuss the exploitation and the oppression that we've been under and try to figure out ways to deal with that and basically to survive. The truth of the matter is that we are part of an ongoing years, hundreds and hundreds of years of struggle against the slaveocracy and the mentality of it. And I see it as us as being this a continuation of this nation of people who were kidnapped, whose ancestors were kidnapped wrongfully, brought to these shores against their will, and that we would have to come together as one. I grew up in a small town called Morgan City. It was known as Brass Hill. It's in the southern part of Louisiana, about 50 miles from the Caribbean, the northern Caribbean, what's known as the Gulf of Mexico, in the Mississippi Delta, where the Mississippi River deltas out into the Gulf. So it's a lot of swamp area there. And I grew up, it was segregated across the tracks. There was no integration. And so all like, it's like a black nation. Main activities were fishing and hunting. We used to catch catfish at the river and sell the catfish 10 cents clean and 5 cents if you didn't have time to clean them. My mother and father and three sisters and three brothers, I was the youngest, and we were brought up in the church. I was an altar boy until I was, 15. We had to go serve on the altar every morning and say the mass in Latin and all that. And then that's how we started out today, because our mother would make us come with her. And my father was a junk man, was known as, you think of Red Fox, he wasn't funny like that, but he refused to work for any boss, and I think that came to me in my genes, all of us. Then that's how he raised his whole family, until he fell with a stroke when I was about 15. So far as the community, typical black southern community, a lot of Creoles in southern Louisiana, a lot of Creole. There's a lot of good feelings, crawfish bars and shrimp bars. So it was a very rich experience for me, you know. When we went hunting and fishing, if Miss Hazel across the street, old Miss Virginia needed some fish, or she needed some rice or some, this is largely a sugar cane area where I'm from. Sugar cane and whatnot, they got that. It was shared. If a hog was killed, everybody got a part of that hog. And so I saw a lot of socialism before I knew what socialism was. A lot of that, you know, closeness, that affinity from a community. But I don't recall police coming up, right? I remember the first time I ever saw the inside of a jail, I was about 11 or 12. My brother and I was walking down from playing ball with a friend of ours down by the levee. And it was these other two boys who was with us who were sons of a poker fisherman. Poker fishermen are like migrant farm workers you see out here. They follow the poker fish. They come from the East Coast all the way down into the Caribbean or the Gulf of Mexico. And so they had been there like about a week, and they were walking with us, and this girl was coming the same way, so you know, it's customary down in segregated South, you cross the street so you won't pass on the same side. So when she got parallel to us, one of the poker fisherman's sons hollered her name, "Hey Linda," you know. And this was, "You don't do this down here." So we don't do this down here, you know. And we kept on walking. About an hour later, first time I ever remember the police came to our house and put me and my brother in jail for speaking to a white woman. That's the first time I ever saw the inside of a jail. I think it was about 11 or 12. A year after, my brother and I and about four of us, maybe five, had went trick-or-treating. And, you know, I come from a real kind of close family structure. They wouldn't let you venture out too far. So the place we went trick-or-treating was okay, was cleared by our people and stuff. When we got near the tracks coming back, two trucks stopped, and it was a Klan. They jumped out, and everybody started running. And so we got to running, and they got my brother. And I didn't realize it because I thought he was in the front of me. And they was beating him pretty bad. I started coming back when I realized they had gotten my brother. Before I could get back, my older brother, one of my older brothers was there, my sister, my daddy, my mama, all of the people out the alley from, it looked like about 10, 15 seconds, it was, stop what they were doing. It was about 7 at night, right? And they backed up right quick, and I grabbed my brother, and it was a very emotional thing. Then we found out later that it was someone had taken their children's trick-or-treat candy way on the other side of the swamps. So they just came to get, like they say, any nigga will do. But the dignity, the feeling you would feel when things like that happen is very similar to what happened after the shootout in Los Angeles years later. How the community was responding, the feeling you would get after you done backed these dogs down, you see? They shouldn't have been there, and the people stood up, and they defeated them. That sense of nationalism, that sense of protection, that people banded together against these evil forces, won out.
Geronimo graduated from high school in 1965 and enlisted in the Army. He served 3 years in Vietnam, receiving many commendations. While in Vietnam, he was sprayed with the chemical defoliant Agent Orange. He continues to experience chronic sinus inflammation from this exposure. The prison refuses to treat this condition.
It's 1968. I'm getting out of the service. I was riding down the streets. The police, black and white squad cars, it was about 5 or 6 of them, lights flashing. And as I came closer, I noticed this helicopter, like it come out of nowhere, it seemed like, and it had this big bull light. We just call them bull lights. And that very familiar helicopter, it just left, jumping out of them in Vietnam, And it's right there, and I'm driving down the streets. And as I got closer, I was able to see they had these black people lying down on their face. On their stomach. And it was hard. It was hard pill to swallow. And then I began to draw what I was about to say, the most important thing, the parallels. I go through Watts, I go through Chicago, I go through Harlem. And I see that the people in the what's called a ghetto, the black communities or the colonies or whatever you want to call it, were treated almost exactly the way we just got through treating Viet Cong or Vietnamese people in Vietnam. So I begin to draw parallels. The police departments in these various situations, in these cities, were actually the same thing we were in Vietnam, occupying forces. They didn't live in the communities. They came from another area. They didn't know the inhabitants of that community. And they were exploiting, they were imprisoning, killing, a lot of killing, just blacks at random, and it's still happening today. So it had a very strong effect that I had to stand up. I felt as though it was incumbent upon me to stand up and strike out against these things, to stand and to resist these things. And that was one of the main motivations that propelled me into the movement back then, coming from Vietnam.
Raised in a good home, best education, loved by young and old, each and every generation. Fought in Vietnam, trained with green berets till the secret war turned the other way.
What can you do to help you? Okay, you have these skills, you have these skills. When you draw back upon your skills, well, I could help feed children. I got a car. I could help with transportation as I'm studying, right? And then the people who were killed, like trying to prevent these police from doing this in the community, these pigs, that's why they were called pigs, from coming, exploiting the community, were just outnumbered. They were outmatched. They were outclassed. Most of them didn't even know how to load a weapon and stuff. So I saw where I had this knowledge, even before the Army, we knew about weaponry and stuff. So I was able to help educate them to that, which alarmed. Oh, well, you taught weapons, you goddamn right, and I'll teach it again. I'll teach them, these people are killing our people. And there's nothing wrong with that. If you find something wrong, that's your problem, We could deal with that, but these people are not going to go out here on these streets trying to protect their families and be killed because they don't know the right side of a weapon. They're going to know at least this much how to defend themselves and help them with that. So I was able, I felt good about doing that. We constitute the third, this is controversial, largest grouping of African people on the face of the planet right here in this country. Next to Nigeria is the first. I think Nigeria have something like 90 million. In this country, you have something, they've been saying 22 million, so something upwards to 50 million. You say 40 to be conservative. You talk to a person of African descent here, and it only occurs in this country, they give you bloodlines back to their former slave masters, and are proud of it. My name Washington, my name Johnson. And do not realize the importance of having your historical identity intact. You have these attitudes of the people that, if it's called a plebiscite, was taken as a national vote. If that was taken, I'm willing to, after all I've studied and even being away for so long, still willing to bet that the vote would come out nationhood, that we do not need your president, we do not need your Supreme Court, we do not need your Congress. We have the resources to fend for that ourselves. We have people, if we want to have presidents, or a commissar, or whatever you want it to be. We have enough, to have doctors. We have enough to have our own Supreme Courts, to have our own nation. Then we can fend for ourselves and be recognized as a nation. One of the largest nations in the world. I think it's only about 9 or 10 nations that would have more of a population than we would have. It would only be maybe about 6 nations that would only have a larger economy than we would have. Already it's, $400 billion to the black community? We already have everything to say that we are a nation. Okay, I'm a prisoner of war because of a secret war that was waged against the Black Liberation Movement in the 60s. I am a prisoner of war because, number one, I did not do what they accused me of doing. And it's, we have facts to support that and prove that now. what I did do, I have not bitten my tongue. I don't bite my tongue. I'm not ashamed of, and I talk freely about it all throughout these years, which caused a lot of problems for a lot of people because they don't like to hear it. But this is me and this is truth. I'm a member, I'm a soldier in the ranks of liberation for our people.
I just happened to finish just recently a movie about another political prisoner, Nelson Mandela. And I apologize when I met Jaga Pratt. I apologize for not talking about Geronimo Pratt in my interviews when I talk about Nelson. Because it still is the same thing that both political prisoners.
Well, here we have a case where the community all around this country is coming out and saying, we want this man free, we want him out of prison. And I just would like to end by quoting a piece in the Oakland Tribune this morning about Geronimo, an editorial asking if he's released. And it ends like this, sounds like a model citizen to me. He'd be a credit to his community if the state would only let him have one. Well, the state is stopping him. It's the state in here. It's the parole board. It's the FBI. It's the people who have made a career on Geronimo's imprisonment.
Then when you begin to view your community as a family, then your nation as a family, then you reach those levels of concern, which everybody would like to see. But it first starts with your being concerned about your mother and your father, your auntie and your uncle, your grandmother and your grandfather, your son and your daughter, your sister and your brother. Then on from there, their sisters and their brother, the extended family, the humanitarian concern, all this is based on one thing. It's based on love.
Thousands of people nationally and internationally realize that Geronimo Pratt should be free. The television program 60 Minutes revealed that 4 of the 5 jurors interviewed by CBS would have found Geronimo not guilty if they had known then the facts uncovered since the trial.
Walk on, peace, walk on, peace, They just wanna see me big shuffle and trip on a free.